Howdy and welcome to Burley United Methodist Church's worship service for February 19th. We are grateful that you could tune us in and join us, whether you're in the area or somewhere around the world. I still have chaplain friends who call me up or text me every week and critique each service. So I worry about some of you out there not doing, having, that's what you're in. Your height of enjoyment is. But we are grateful that you could tune us in, and may the Spirit of Jesus Christ warm you and fill you with God's love this day and every day. Our slavery history class, our anti-slavery, our anti-racism class, we are continuing on for two more weeks this week, and then we will finish it up for the winter. And so if you are in the area, we will be meeting at 12:30. Our opening hymn this morning is, "Oh, Sacred Head, Now Wounded." The call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 1, as well as Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. I'll ask you to respond to the bold, and I will read the light print. Gather with the crowds who seek to touch Jesus. Come to hear and be healed. We are poor and hungry, in need of food for our souls. Cursed are those who put their trust in human beings and make flesh their arm. Blessed are those who put their trust in God and find their hope in Christ Jesus. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Our faith is not in vain, and our hope is sure. We rejoice and leap for joy at the good news. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Great planter and provider, we rejoice at the streams of living water you send within our reach. Help us to grow deep roots that partake of your truth and thick branches that reach out in loving support to all in need of your embrace. In this hour we seek with enthusiasm the energy you provide as we sense your presence. Blessing us. Amen. Our next hymn is As the Deer. Please join me in prayer. Oh God, you have set forth your law, and we seek to obey your commandment. You have set apart a people and called them holy. We endeavor to respond to your grace and to proclaim your glory. In Christ's name, you have commissioned us to be stewards of your mysteries, bringing justice to bear where injustice prevails. We strive to serve you as ambassadors of good news, offering our labors in love to restore others to life. Hear us as we pray for our neighbors in need. Then give us the courage to transform our words into actions. We pray for the poor, the homeless, and those who live in the streets. Protect them from those who would prey upon them, and use us to find ways to shelter and feed them. Grant that we shall not take them lightly, since you have called them blessed. We pray for those who must steal to survive. Lead us as we seek ways for society to share so that all may live. Where systems keep persons out of work, impel us to change those systems. As we chain our doors for our protection, may we also change our ways so that peace and security may abide in the land. We pray for those in homes, institutions, and jails. Be with those who serve them, performing their duties. Be with those who miss them, keeping their vigils of hope. Be Be with us who intercede on their behalf. May we seek dignity for them in spite of their condition. O God, we will not squander your goodness or take lightly your grace. As you commission us in Christ, so empower us with the Holy Spirit that we may show ourselves trustworthy to have been set aside for your praise. Lord, we pray all these petitions, both spoken and in silence, in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, who taught his disciples when they prayed to say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. A few years ago, I attended a conference in Denver. And as I was talking to my friend, a guitarist came out on stage and began to play and sing James Taylor's Up on the Roof. And after a while, it sounded pretty good. And then I looked and I realized that it was James Taylor. No wonder he sang it so well. Forgiving is not a personal characteristic that is in vogue today. Why is that? What prohibits us or hinders us from forgiving? Is it our attitude? Is it what they did that offended us? And the question that I am dealing with, and hopefully by the end of I'm done with all of this, I'll have an answer. I know I'm supposed to forgive. That's part of the covenant that we have with God forgiving us. But doesn't the person first have to come to confess and seek my forgiveness? For decades, in South Africa, Bishop Desmond Tutu has been the spiritual voice for those who were persecuted during the brutal decades of that country's apartheid government. Tutu preached that without forgiveness, there is no future for their nation. I don't remember how my childhood friend Chris injured his arm, but after the initial healing, the bandage came off and there was just a scab about the size of a silver dollar that remained. All year in seventh grade, Chris kept picking at that scab. And in time, the skin did heal. But because the skin was not allowed to heal properly, it became discolored. And I think our interpersonal relationships are a lot like Chris's injury. Without forgiveness, they never really heal and they never are really the same. There is no recipe for forgiveness. If you gave four of your friends your recipe for lasagna and asked them to make a plate of lasagna just like you, while they would all come up very similar, they would probably not all taste the same. Forgiveness is not a recipe. Forgiveness comes first from God and then from your heart. While God's heart is consistent, ours, each one of ours is unique. All five lasagna makers may have been hurt by the same person, and there's a good chance that not all of you will forgive that person at the same rate. There can be unintended secondary consequences, that by embracing a forgiveness culture, we may see offenders escape responsibility. Embracing a forgiveness culture is radical. But that is the only way a family or a couple, a community, can get on with their lives. The only alternative to forgiveness is vengeance and violence, whether it is personal or state sanctioned, such as the Nuremberg trials after World War II. Forgiveness is hard. We live in a culture where justice is demanded and where those who did wrong are constantly called upon to atone for their sins. So many Americans are offended even when the topic of forgiveness is brought up. Whether it is the Me Too movement or the Black Lives Matter, judgment is where the pendulum has now swung to after decades of sweeping abuse and racism under the rug. The church embracing the forgiveness culture was evident after the tragic murder of 9 African Americans in a church in Charleston, South Carolina, by Dylan Roof. The forgiveness given by those grieving families were condemned by the Black community. One person wrote, "Our constant forgiveness perpetuates the cycle of attacks and abuse." Are we not supposed to have an attitude of constant forgiveness? Is that not what Jesus preached? Is that not what we have already prayed this morning? Forgiveness is supposed to disarm our opponents and win them and their supporters over, and in doing so, weaken the systems of violence and injustice and racism. We need to live in a society where forgiveness and justice can coexist. I propose to choose one over the other. It doesn't work. People need to be forgiven, and no institution is better to do that. No institution is better suited to lead this movement than the church. We as the church must take the lead in forgiving others. If we do not, we lose our credibility. We need for forgiveness. The need for forgiveness is undeniable. We as the church must not only grant forgiveness, but we must also do honestly and sincerely. Early on in Christ's ministry, a group of 4 brought their friend who could not walk to a house in Capernaum where Jesus was speaking, hoping that Jesus would heal their friend. And we pick up the story in Mark chapter 4, chapter 2, verse 4. And when they could not bring him in to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and after having dug through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. The roof, or most roofs, or if all roofs, in the Palestinian house was flat. It was regularly used as a place to get away from the hustle and bustle of life and to enjoy the cool of the evening. The construction of a Palestinian roof lent itself to what the 4 friends did. Usually the roof consisted of beams laid across from wall to wall at about 36 inches apart. Such construction today would not pass inspection. And the space in between the beams would be filled with brush and packed tightly with grass. The top was then covered with a less porous material. Sometimes the roof was used as an auxiliary garden to grow food or grasses or to absorb the rainwater rather than have it to drip in the house. So it would not have been hard for this group of four to dig out and the filling between the two beams without severely damaging the integrity of the roof. Likewise, the construction of the roof would make it easy to repair what had been lifted away. What an opportunity for Jesus to show his miraculous powers. All he had to do was look at this man and say, "Get up and walk." Rather, Jesus looked up through this big hole in the roof and saw the four faces looking down upon him and their friend. And Jesus saw their faith. Jesus then turned his attention to their friend who was laying down there before him. And he said, "Your sins are forgiven." This connection between the need for forgiveness and disease was common in Jesus' day and even before. In the book of Job, confronts the connection, but that's what they believed back then. Suffering was a result of sinning. To the Jews, an ill person was one with whom God was angry. Early on in the book of Job, his quote-unquote friend Eliphaz asks Job, "Who that is innocent has ever been punished?" Job wanted to say, "Me." And in the Gospel of John, in the ninth chapter, the whole chapter deals with the responsibility of a young man's blindness. Was it his sin or was it his parents' sin? Try to imagine that you are this person that's being lowered down. You have been unable to walk since you were born, unable to hold a job, unable to provide and be a husband, unable to provide and be a father. And you hear, "Your sins have been forgiven." My reaction would have been something like, "Thank you, Jesus. I appreciate that my sins are forgiven. But I am now somewhere between 20 and 100% responsible for replacing someone's roof. And I would very much like to leave this house in a different manner in which I came. Thank you again for forgiving my sins, but believe it or not, I have more urgent things to do." And the words that I would say as a pastor to that person or to anyone is, no. There is nothing more urgent than having your sins forgiven. It is likely that man was lowered through the roof and had been thinking, if only I could walk again, I would be happy. I'd never complain. I would be content for the rest of my life. But our Lord is making the point, look around at all these people here. They all can walk. How are their hearts? Are they happy? Are they content? What the man and his friends wanted, which Jesus could grant, would offer unbridled joy for maybe a week or two. But what about the rest of his life? What then? Jesus may have been thinking, if only If only I did what you wanted me to do, would that be enough? I can give you better. And what the man needed was forgiveness. Forgiveness gets to the bottom of things. Forgiveness is a big part of recovery, like AA. Recovery, true recovery, for someone can only come after they have hit bottom. Any attempt to short circuit or cut corners in their recovery process will only perpetuate it. Forgiveness gets down to the bottom of things, the alienation we feel from God and from ourselves because of sin. Our Lord wanted to show this man what he really needed, and it's Jesus. For only he can bestow perfect love, new identity, endless comfort, hope, and grace. The only door one can enter to receive all of these gifts is the door of forgiveness. Unlike the scripture passage where Jesus says, "I stand at the door and knock," this time Jesus is on the inside, and we are the ones on the outside knocking. And at times there are those who aren't even knocking, who may have even turned their back on the door. But God is there and he opens up the door of forgiveness. All we got to do is walk through. In the 3 minutes that I have left, I want to at least define forgiveness. Forgiveness means giving up on the right to seek revenge, as well as the right to seek repayment from the one who has harmed you. Such an act can only be characterized as voluntary suffering. When Janice and I lived in the Magic Valley before, Janice and two friends were driving back from Portland and the car rolled 3 times. I could have sued the driver for compensation, but I thanked him deeply for making sure that my wife was alive. When I forgave him, I took on the cost of replacing my car. To forgive is redirecting how the debt is to be collected. Somebody always has to pay. After what's happened, there are only 2 things that you can do. First, you can try to restore that which has been taken from you by repaying them in the same manner that you were hurt, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Or you can forgive them. Refuse to inflict the same hurt and pain and absorb the damage. The result of every sin is that there is a debt to be paid because someone has suffered. Somebody has to pay. Either the guilty party is made to suffer, or that person is forgiven. Forgiveness is costly. Forgiveness is emotionally taxing. It is taxing because first you refuse to seek vengeance upon the other. But if you say you are forgiven, then you must forgive. You can't keep dredging up the past and replay the sin over and over and throwing it in their face. If you say that they do not owe you anything, then you cannot demand repayment. If they are forgiven, then you must treat them as you treated them before. And second, by refusing to seek vengeance, you are willing to give up of what was taken from you. By forgiving them, you are in effect saying, what is done is done. And third, whatever ill will you have in your heart must be purged. That experience must be tossed in the garbage. I truly believe that forgiveness is granted before it is felt. Forgiving someone is a promise not only to do these things and to rely on God's grace. Forgiveness will make you a better person and a far better Christian by allowing you to love others and to live in peace rather than to live in bitterness. God's grace is just like being there at that conference, listening not just to a James Taylor song, but listening to James Taylor. I wasn't expecting that. Neither are we expecting God's grace and forgiveness when we forgive others. When we wrong God, there are two options. First is to suffer for our sins. Second is that God does not seek revenge, but forgives, and in doing so absorbs the pain of our sins. On the cross, we see God forgiving us, and that is only possible if God suffers. On the cross, God's love satisfies God's own justice by suffering the penalty of sin. There is never forgiveness without suffering, never. All we have to do is to look to the cross to remember that, and to remember who was on the cross and who died and suffered for our sins. Gracious God, we come to you this day and we are in awe of your love. We are in debt, and we are so very grateful that that debt has already been paid, and we are now only obliged to do all that we can in response to your love. Guide us, O God. Guide us today. This we pray. Amen. Thank you. And our final hymn this morning is God Will Be With You Till We Meet Again. May God, who watches over all righteousness, give you the gifts needed to be a capable servant. May Jesus Christ, who welcomes everyone, give you the loving heart of a child so that you can welcome others unconditionally. May the Holy Spirit, who gives us the understanding we need to love God and to forgive others, give us unselfish and generous hearts to heal relationships and to live in peace. Amen.